All right, guys, good afternoon. My name is Jamie.
Ben Yu.
And we're here today to talk about our project proposal, which involves auditing with virtual reality. We're going to actually start by showing you guys a quick clip that kind of demonstrates how virtual reality can benefit. We don't really need the sound. Yeah, it's okay. So this is him like strapping on the virtual reality. They have a green screen just so that we can see what he's seeing. But basically, this is kind of what it would look like. You're here in a virtual world. You have these two handheld devices which allow you to interact with the world, and you can bring up data tables and things like that just as simply as you would on a computer. The benefit here, obviously, as you can see, is, which you will see in a minute, is not only can you visualize the data from the three-dimensional point of view, but you can actually use these hand tools to sort through the data and use traditional analytic tools that we would normally use on Excel, but also you can use these things to scale the data and explore the data by actually clicking on it exactly what you want to see. So that's just a brief kind of overview of what it would sort of look like in this environment. So this obviously can help. We're thinking this could help auditors perform more efficient audit, because if they have all the data around them, there are other examples that you can see where it's a wall with all the graphs and you can see all the graphs in front of you just by turning your head instead of having to switch between the different types of charts. So that obviously will hopefully allow them to do this quicker. And then obviously the other thing is we're hoping it will allow them to make better judgments, because all of the facts will be in front of them. They won't have to remember pieces of information that may be red flags. And hopefully they'll be able to sort through it a little better. But Ben's gonna go over a little bit more on the background here.
Yes, so we look for the judgmental things about the information processing or recognition. Have you heard about the Milner's magic number 7. It is the relating with the human's short-term memory. So usually people can remember up to the 7 things. And after Milner, they argued, some people argued 4, or some people argued 3 to 5, but there is a certain limitation for the human's short-term memory. So we try to extend those short-term memory limitations by using the visual data add or help. But usually the auditors bring their notebook because they need to some place to other place, yeah, from time to time already. So they use very limited short display of the laptop. So it's limited to the size of visual app, which is extending the limitation of the human memory. So we applied our proposal into the Kinney's 3 paragraphs. So we will study, what we will study is the relationship between the workable space, which means to short size display and as contrast to the large workable space, and the efficiency or accuracy about the auditor's performance. And why is it important? If we increase the efficiency of the auditors, we can concentrate on more risk area, and if we spend more time on the risk area, we can increase the audit quality or audit quality. And if we directly increase the accuracy, it means to increase the audit quality. So it is important. And also, I think the effect is more dramatically on the auditors, because as I mentioned, auditors use always bring its own laptop and limited size of the display. And how
can I interrupt? So just want to clarify, what you're describing is not only increasing auditor efficiency, because accuracy would not be efficiency, right? Accuracy
yes.
would be a measure of effectiveness.
We're testing both.
Right, so you're testing both, but in here you say or accuracy, but you're actually testing both. Efficiency and accuracy.
Yes.
Accuracy, efficiency, and effectiveness.
So both.
how we will conduct the study. We will separate this group with the traditional using the laptop display and the other group using the virtual reality tools. And we will give in some accounting balances or accounting statement, and which has some inter-conflicting situation or data. So the participants be asked to find out those things. And this how part we will elaborate to the JMU.
Alright, so the actual experimental design that we came up with is as follows. First, we're going to establish a data set, and what we're going to do there is we're going to take, hopefully, actual financial statements and pair them with an actual account balances. But what we're going to do is we're going to alter the account balances so that they can't add up to the financial statement amount. And what we're trying to do is get both groups of auditors to find what those accounts are. So the first control group will be given the data traditionally on the laptop, and they'll have to sift through it on the one screen and come up with a list of problematic accounts that they want to further test. And then the experimental group, obviously not everyone understands how to use virtual reality, so we're going to give them some basic training first. But once they have the basic training, we're going to give them the same information with the same analytic tools, and the only difference hopefully will be the use of virtual reality. And they'll be asked to do the same task to identify the accounts that don't match with the financial statement amounts. The whole process also is going to be timed. That's how we're going to be able to tell if they do it quicker or slower. And we also wanted to ask when they're done for an explanation of why they drew those conclusions. This isn't really to test one of the things that we're trying to test in the experiment. This is to test if the experiment is working properly. There could be some reason that the virtual reality people are picking different accounts that has to do with the actual experimental design that we're overlooking. But also, we want to collect this information because it could be used in a further study. And then the three controls that we have are the auditor experience. So both sets of auditors obviously have to be the same level of experience. We're giving them the same data set, and they will have the same analytic tools within the virtual reality world as they put on their laptop.
So coming back, I'm a little, I want to make sure I understand the experimental task. So you're going to give them a set of financial statements, which is what they're using, and then you're going to give them detailed data, right? And so the detailed data, for example, might be a sales journal. Okay. And then the test group, or the control group, I should say, not the test group, the control group will have the same thing that they have on their laptops, right? They give them. So my only concern with that is that that's such a 0-1 task. Does it agree or does it not agree, right? So what you might capture, I don't know that you will capture accuracy as much, which is I think
more than. Well, we also don't want to alter all of them. We just want to alter some of them so that when we ask them, they'll be able to, like we may falsely identify what they call risky accounts that we haven't actually altered.
But I understand what you're saying. But what I'm saying is I don't know that the experimental task as designed will get you to at least one of your DVs, which is accuracy, right? Because it, to me, it's easier, right? If you're as an auditor, I'm automatically comparing totals, right? So I'm going to look at sales job, okay, that's not in the general ledger. So it might take me more time on my laptop, but I think I'll be just as accurate as someone going in a virtual reality.
And that may be the case. Well, we're not sure if it would. But at least if you do it faster in virtual reality, there's still a benefit you provide to the audience.
Right. No, and I'm not.
That's still efficient. But
right.
The accuracy measure is a little trickier.
Right.
Than that.
Right.
Because it's about, and then with it only being kind of a 0-1, like does it agree, doesn't it agree,
is more objective, right? Whereas what I'm suggesting to you, I think it's, I'm saying you can have try to achieve the same by using a different task, right? So, and I'm not suggesting, an example might be something that requires them to use judgment, right? So if you could still see errors, right? And say, okay, look at the relationship. Does the relationship between, are they better able to identify, let's say for example, the relationship between the change in revenue as compared to what the change in accounts receivable is. That's just an example off the top of my head.
So by giving them like year over year data?
Right, year over year data. But that's the thing, you don't even have to give them year over year data, right? You give them 2 years of information, right? You can see some errors. Like you can see in, same as you were gonna do with it doesn't foot, you can see in errors that where the relationship doesn't fit. So they have to generate a hypothesis about what could be going on. Right, like what could be the problem? So let's say, for example, sales is going down between year one and year two, but we see an increase in accounts receivable. Well, there are a couple of hypotheses, right? One could be there's a collection issue, so which is why accounts receivable is growing. And so their allowance for doubtful accounts or valuation might be an issue. Or another could be they just simply changed. The company changed its approach to, or its credit terms, right? So which, so you could kind of track it.
This was actually the part that we got most hung up with when we were designing the whole thing. And we settled on this one. I think, like, originally we were gonna do ratios, we were gonna go like year over year analysis, but then our concern was like, if you just look at it straight up on a graph and there's like a huge blip, it'll be very easy for you to determine that. So we wanted to do something like, the idea behind this was we weren't gonna tell them there was a problem with the accounts,
right.
We were just gonna ask them what accounts they thought were risky. But we kind of were at a loss for an idea that does like a little more element of judgment.
Right.
How do you, like, when I was doing my dissertation, one of the things that always, you know, when you're trying to think of a judgment task, you know, have them assess risk, right? So if are we saying that by using virtual reality, we can encourage the auditor to be more skeptical when faced with certain seeded deficiencies or whatever you want to call it? Because whenever you're trying to decide whether or not something constitutes risk, as you talked about risky accounts, right? There is a level of judgment there. But the task of saying, does it foot, does it not foot, does it
So we originally out. Came up with the idea of just can you rank what you would consider to be the most risky accounts, or what areas would you see to be the most risk?
Mm-hmm.
But our concern with that is, obviously there's a lot of judgment in that, so how would we really be able to
measure it? And I agree, that would be ranking it and having the account not foot is not going to make the account risky, because sales might tie out to the general ledger perfectly. It's still risky, right?
So if we ask them to, if we alter the accounts and ask them to determine like the fraud risk based on the amount of issues that they found, would that be a possible solution?
Well, you would have to have fraud risk factors. So to me, when I read this, right, what's cool about this is in the VR space, right, is just turn your head, so you have more information at your fingertips, right? So you don't necessarily have to go searching through your work papers for it, and you might follow a different path with virtual, right? So you would have to have something that's fraud risk factors in there, so you could have accounts, like a fraud risk factor might be, again, something that the example that I just gave, I'm not suggesting you use that example, I'm just trying to give you some context, is that there could be some different, you know, that relationship doesn't make sense. I'm not saying that relationship, you know, that there's a problem, but that's a red flag for me. That relationship, because I already have a preconceived notion. Like, I expect that accounts receivable and sales are kind of moved in the same direction, right, just because of the double entry system, right?
So a possible task could be like, if you rank the riskiness of the company, and then, or like, because I think the issue that we had with the risk assessment was that how you compare the results, right, between the two groups.
Well, I'll give you an example. Because you have that, what you would do is look for more information, right? So what I would argue, based on the limited knowledge I have of what you presented here, is that VR gives me more access to information in a timely way, right? So because it's there in front of me in this tool, and it's just a matter of turning my head and I can point at it and drill down on it, I'm going to search more. So my information search increases. I look at more, right, then I would necessarily, so maybe I don't fall prey to confirmation bias, and I start to explore, let me disconfirm the rationale, you know, or the explanation at manager. What could be the other reason driving the change in this account? So it's just, you could still do what you're doing, but exploit the fact that you have so much information and see how auditors search through that information, right? Because right now, you're absolutely right, on my laptop, I gotta go, I gotta look at this account, then I gotta kind of drill down and see, you know, now I need the general ledger, the sales journal to see what's going on. Versus in VR, I can say, okay, well, let me look at bad debt expense, let me look at the accounts that, you know, I can actually see when, you know, what's the history of the of payment. I could look at board of directors minutes or, you know, any internal correspondence that would suggest to me that, yes, we changed our term. I could pull up the aging receivable, you know, aging listing right away and see what's going on. So I have more information at my fingertips than I necessarily, it reduces my search, right, time. Right? And I'm likely to search for more information because it's right there in front of me.
So you would ask them for an overall risk evaluation?
Right, you can ask them a number of questions, right? But you, in your VR, and even in your on a laptop, right, you can track what information they search for.
Oh.
Right? And that tells you something. That gives you some information because are they searching for the wrong thing? Are they searching for the right thing? Did they hone in on what would be really relevant to address that?
I didn't think about using logs, but that consideration was when you gave for the explanation. Like, we were hoping that explanation would, well, when I looked at this kind of stuff, and then we can see, okay, well, the VR people looked into this, but the other people didn't even bother looking at that.
Right, you could ask them too. You could say, well, what did you look at? But you could use logs. I didn't even think about that. But yeah, you could use the logs and see how what they searched on.
Okay, so that's definitely something we have to do.
Yeah.
How to measure, like, we have to get them to measure the risk more subjectively then.
Or make it a judgment task, right? Where, because I think where auditors are most prone to errors are not when it's very objective. It's where it's more subjective. Where they, and I think something like this is where, that's where the bag is. If I'm a firm, and I'm using VR, I'm going to spend the money investment in VR because it's going to help my auditors, you know, become better at critical thinking and improving their, you know, enhancing skepticism, and, right? And I don't need to be skeptical about does the account, either the account puts or it doesn't. That's, I can, you know, that's just like a basic audit procedure to make sure. And even in my, but also, in my, on my computer now with IDEA, I don't have to, you know, do a sum, right? So the task is not.
So we would ask them more for a risk assessment based on the seated accounts.
Oh, yeah, or look at the look at the literature on the audit literature. Just think about this. Let me think about what task, because I think this is something you guys should explore. Look at the audit research on analytical procedures, and that's the planning stage of the audit. And one of the things is, and that's something that's not gonna change, I don't care what tool you use, auditors have to, I mean, the standards require it, that you perform analytical procedures, and the prior research has demonstrated that auditors are just not, yeah, they can perform the procedures, so they can do the mathematical calculation, and they can say, oh yes, it changed, and it went up, it went down, but it's now what hypothesis, because the whole point of analytical procedures is to draw a hypothesis. You know, in the planning stages, it's attention directed. So if you make the wrong inferences, you're gonna make the wrong decisions about where you should be focusing your attention.
I think that this is an interesting idea. I just met with talked to two of the firms Tuesday yesterday, and one of the things that one of them brought up was that we were talking about visualization, right? And so if you kind of think about this as a live visualization where the auditor's kind of immersed in it, that what she was saying is that they really kind of take it as an opportunity for the data to tell a story, recognize patterns, and
is all stuff that we thought could be the case. If we watch a little more of the video, there's a really good example that he has of three-dimensional data that you can't really see on a screen. But it's like a two-dimensional screen, but when you plot it all out and you can stand over it, you can see how the data changes. I think they plotted the popularity of the mean between girls and boys and set of years or whatever. And you get the story a lot better. So we didn't really want to be too specific when we started the write-up and went through all this, because we didn't know what you could really find with this.
This is exploratory.
Yeah.
Right, it's exploratory.
So, but the general concept behind coming up with this idea was Ben's idea of like increasing workspace availability, and in VR you have the entire world as your workspace, so you can kind of do a lot more, and we're trying to see like how that play. I mean, we thought also about, before we got to VR, like, oh, what if you just use like a bunch of screens versus one screen or something like that, but I think the effects in this will be much greater, but I don't really know how.
I think you should go with this. I think it's really, I don't know how you do VR
how you get people. Like, we don't have a VR environment, so. But you
it's
know.
Just a matter of getting a headset and some tools.
Really?
Not convince Rutgers. Yeah, I mean, the whole environment that he created there, mm-hmm. most of that was what they call a VR lab, which allows us to see what he's seeing.
Mm-hmm.
But the tools that he was using, the headset and the thing, that's
mm-hmm.
like standard equipment.
And you know what? But you know, we have here at Rutgers, we have a behavioral lab, and maybe that's something we could talk to the behavioral lab about incorporating VR in there. So I think that's a good idea. And if it's that simple, because they have a behavioral lab, we could, you could run, use something, a simpler task,
just
and run this with students, right?
Just a test.
Yep.
Just about one. And then they can use it.
Yeah, but I mean, you would want to run it at several, right? You want
several machines,
right? Because if you're doing an experiment, right, you need more than one, right? So you would want to, we wouldn't have, obviously we're not going to have 90 of them,
yeah.
But I don't know how expensive they are. Maybe they are, but we could, right? You know, and then you would run the experiment at the same time, right? With different individuals, obviously. So, but I mean, I think if it's that simple, it's certainly something we're pursuing, and we could talk about it more.
Which is good. You always want your research idea to be interesting. Right.
And you can run it with students. You can come up with a task that simulates an audit task, something that an auditor would do, right? It doesn't have to. They obviously students wouldn't have the expertise as auditors, so the task would have to be something within their wheelhouse.
We're not testing anything that requires any
right.
All right, and then the final slide we have is the Libby 5 boxes. So on the independent side, we're trying to see if the use of virtual reality will affect the auditor's performance. So the dependent variable on the conceptual level will be like superior audit performance, the way we operationalize those. On the use of virtual reality, are they using a laptop or are they using virtual reality? And then on the dependent side, we're testing to see if the information processing time changes and also if the accuracy of identification for the two things that we have in our initial experiment, how they perform, are they more accurate? And then our three controls that we came up with so far are experience, data, and analytical tools.
So the only thing on this, right, your conceptual is not the use of virtual reality is how you're testing your conceptual, right? So really, right? So at the conceptual level, what you're saying is that, I don't know.
Oh, the increased workspace.
Right, or something like that, or right, you know, which is your conceptual.
So then the use of virtual reality would just be here in operation.
Right, that's how you operationalize
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Right, so you're really, let's say improve auditor judgment or something like that, or something, I guess.
Yeah.
But
okay, that's the presentation.
Okay, great. Okay.
Basic idea is about the industry.
So just to recap the idea, so we have auditors specializing in different fields. It's highly unlikely that each field, so the determinants, so we want to test fraud risk assessment. Okay. Anything that requires judgment, which is established. And also we know that different industries have might have the same determinants of fraud, but they don't think that each the importance, the ranking of the determinants is the same. So in some industry, a missing entry might be considered a big thing, and in some other industry, it might not be as big of a thing as something else. And we're just going in blind right now, so we're not making any assumptions about which internal control we should keep at the top or planning. So we'll just ask, we plan to gather a set of auditors, small set, big set, depending on how many people we can get and how many industries also. And then we want to see how they identify the determinants of fraud risk and how they rank them. And our hope is that we can develop some kind of an understanding about how the determinants of fraud risk vary across industries. And also we think that this is a good thing because the idea is that if you can have this kind of a measure and auditors will use this kind of a measure to aid them in their judgment, basically because if something is subjective and you have a way to understand it, it's easier. Right? So if you can reduce the subjectivity by a small amount, I think it's good because it reduces a lot of time also. And because it's such a serious issue, if you think that if you're on a borderline kind of a case, and if you say there is a lower amounts of fraud risk, and there is a natural fraud. There are lots of issues, reputation issues, and vulnerability in the world. So what the experiment is going to do is, we're going to have them create a set of factors that they believe are the most important ones that contribute to fraud in their industries. And then we're going to ask them to rank it. And then we hope that they can rank them using numbers, and if not, we propose that we just give them a rank based on the low risk, medium risk or high risk. And I think the low risk, medium risk, high risk thing is better. Because if you give them a rank and you say rank between 0 and 10, someone might say 7, someone might say 6. But it's hard to distinguish. It's very close. So if you just say low, medium, high, I think it's easier for them to rank also. So they don't have to think so much about whether it's a 6, 7, maybe a 5.
Well, you can address that by defining what 1 means and what 7 means.
Yeah, but it's still, when you look at 2 consecutive numbers in a ranking kind of thing, so I rate this.
No, but that's the same, you assign labels to each.
Yeah.
Right? So 6, you're very clear that 1 means, extremely low risk, and 7 means extremely high risk, 2 means, moderately low risk. So you label each number.
Yeah.
And you can explain what is meant.
That's just one of the things that low, medium, high.
But which is fine, but then it doesn't give you a lot of variability, right?
So we plan to do both, actually. So then you can assign grades, right? And this was one of the things that Professor also talked about when he was speaking to us, that assigning grades is really difficult.
Mm-hmm.
And even in his experiment, in his paper, he actually said that this is one of the limitations of my paper. There is no clear way to define dates which we can assign to each control because that's something that we just chose. Right? And we think that if we do the low, medium, high kind of thing, we can avoid that way.
Really what you have here, I know you're calling it an experiment, but what you're conducting is an assessor survey, right? Because you're not manipulating anything.
So manipulating it can come afterwards, right? That once you have the data, and then you can just say that, okay, so these people
not
have...
Not when you're using actual data, you're not manipulating it,
after. As in, like, when you get the results of this survey or whatever, and you can give this to people, a control group who has the results, and
right,
one
now,
that
that's the experiment.
Yeah.
And then,
that's the second
and then,
stage.
Yeah, that's, so
yeah
this
the second stage is
the
experiment.
Right.
So
then we're going to bring it to a control group, which is basically a group of auditors who are not very experienced, and another group of not very experienced auditors, and see how they make their decisions based on this kind of thing.
Yeah,
that's the experiment.
That's the experiment.
So the first part of this experiment is how we get that data and how we give it to the student.
Right.
And then we can judge, we can see, observe how different auditors in different industries rank those things. That's from the first stage. And then we can see how any stage's auditors speak about that. And then we can kind of get a feedback also from that. Like based on actual results, right? So if you see that there is a big fraud and it's because of missing entries or something, we can feedback that into one model. And that's also something that Professor Issa does. So this is basically using Professor Issa's experiment to get the data first and then conduct our own experiment by finding control groups of auditors within industries. So we can get sort of a bigger picture of how these internal controls are working. How much they're doing in
the beginning. So let me understand. I understand the first part. The first part, what you're trying to do is you would survey auditors. Would you survey auditors from, you would select the industries, or you would ask the auditors? Some auditors, either they probably work in multiple industries. Would you ask them to list and rank the fraud risk factors for?
So these are some of the things that I thought about. Okay? So if we ask auditors, so first we can't just say that we're going to choose five industries because we don't know who is going to participate. Okay? So first of all, we're going to ask people.
Well, you can, and then you can go to firms and ask them if they give me people, right? Because you want to control.
That's the second.
You have to really do have to define the
industry.
Maybe what you should do first to help you do that is maybe talk with the different firms and see what industries they cover, right? So you get a consensus of what industries are within.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. We haven't done that, so we can't just say that these are the five industries.
But no, you can say that you're going to do that to define it.
Right. Yeah, I know you have a plan. Right, your plan and approach, right? Because part of this is getting your thing through, how you would approach this, right?
We'll actually go.
Agreed upon framework that auditors use. you know, what are the risk factors in this industry under opportunities for fraudulent financial reporting, for misappropriation of assets, under motivation, under and so forth, right? So you want to, that, those are the things you have to think about, because you want to try, because the minute you have to start try coding, you want to try to minimize the variability of that. So that's really what's the survey part of it. So then you're going to take this survey part of it, because at this point you still haven't manipulated anything, right? And now you're going to come up with something that you're going to test, right, in a model. But before you test that, what you're going to test in your model is not whether or not the lay auditor agrees with that. You're going to use the information that you get from this survey, the weight, to come up with your model. Your experiment will be using the model, right?
Yeah.
Once you've developed the model, to see if the model actually does improve auditor success.
So this was the first part is just getting that survey kind of thing, right? So that we can have something which we can model later on and then present it to the other group. So that is the basic idea.
The behavioral aspect of this particular
comes in the
second
stage.
Typically, there are a lot of theories you want to use, could use to explain your outcomes, but we borrow a lot on site, like why cognitive judgment, decision making, things like that. So when you do come up with hypotheses of what you think this model is going to, how it's going to affect auditors, you know, think about drawing back, okay, like, you know, what sort of biases can we mitigate using this particular tool? Because like you said, the purpose of it, which I'm glad you guys explained it, because I have all these notes, and then I was like, oh, it's not. With this tool, it's important because you recognize off the bat that each industry is going to have different, and maybe having a tool to assist in that can actually aid on it. You have to be careful. We talked about this last week, too, that, you know, there's that checklist literature in auditing, right? Decision aids and how for novice auditors it can be relied upon almost to detriment, you know, where they stop, they ignore subsequent relevant information or things like that. So there's a lot of literature you can draw on to kind of help support, okay, this is why this doesn't apply. So you're going to have people like me asking, okay, wait a minute, is this just going to add another decision aid that novice auditors are going to rely on or not? What do you believe
help your editor in any way make the decision? Why is it just...
Right, so the third part where you said, does this model help the auditor? In what way? Like, this model knows what to
do. So this is just, so if there is some
recognition, recognition...
I mean, this is just another thing that you can look at, right? So if you are, so I think that in the ideal scenario, the kind of turn between a low risk and a medium risk, or a medium risk and a high risk. Thing and get some kind of a reference, maybe that might be one of the cases that we can have.
I think it's worth exploring this actually. Because you have more than just a second.
Overall fraud risk assessment. why. Because you have an outcome there in religion, you know, on the end of that equation, right? And it's just, you know, you probably have a lot more, outcomes that you know, ways that you're capturing it. But like if you were doing an audit fee model, like if right, you on the why, if you would have some question about audit fee, then your X there would be all of the things that are on the right hand side of the equation. Right? If you could just say the audit fee model or something like that or whatever other variables you might be adding to it. And so you could use the living boxes for our pilot because every research question there's an X and there's a Y and there's some controlling variables. The method is just how you test that question, right? How you gather empirical evidence. Some methods, some questions lend themselves to experiment, and some lend themselves to archival. Just you can use the living boxes for archival research as well.
Obviously, use the can't believe thing.
Right.
We said last week, whenever a professor asks you what you're doing, like have a quick 30. You know, this is what I'm doing. As your elevator speech, and then when Nicholas asks you guys to stand up at the end of the Carlisle meetings, and then he only gives you like 1 minute when you prepared your slides, you know? He's like, well, just give us a quick synopsis. He's basically asking for that, right? He's asking for, just tell us real quick. That means he just wants one sentence, kitty three. All right. Thank you. I think you should go.
Easier for us to design a testable
experiment. And our idea came from the paper that we talked last class, which is a paper that testing whether more experts, auditors, or lawyers benefit more from the audit support system. And the result was that the voices might perform worse, even worse, with the help of audit support system. And we want to explore more characteristics that might affect the efficiency of using the audit support system. And we know that males and females have a lot of differences in data processing and reasoning and sync process data. So we want to know whether female or male can better use the audit support system in making decisions, so that we can so that if we have better understanding of this, we can train our auditors based on their characteristics so that they can make better decisions with this support system. And we will show how we can test our hypothesis.
So our experiment comes from the paper of Daniel. And so we just had a little to choose about 40 auditors from the company board. And check if them are female and the other part is male. So we will give them the same information, which includes about 8 relevant information which can be used as tools to fraud risk assessment, and 7 relevant information. And based on that, the participants are told to use the information they have to get their first judgment. And then we will introduce our audit system, the decision support system. So then we will let the auditors to get their second judgment. And we will compare the first one and the second one. No matter whether they change their judgment or not, we will let them to write the reasons down for their decision. And after the experiment, we want to calculate these two rate. The first one is the changing rate, the numbers of changed final decision over 20, and the right decision rate, the number of right judgment over 20. So, and we will compare these two numbers between each group to see if there is any difference between the male auditors and the female auditors.
Okay, so I'm going to stop
before we get to the
one. Yeah. In Danielle's experiment, there were females and there were males, and there's no difference. So you're basically replicating her experiment, and you're saying we're going to replicate it by having an equal number of men and an equal number of women to see if we have any differences. And she didn't report on gender because there was no gender effect, and there was no reason to expect. And so initially when I started reading this, I was thinking that you were going down the line of saying there are elements of decision support systems or technology that may be better suited to women, and there are other elements that might be better suited to men. And in an audit environment, what can we learn that of these various, which of these elements are particularly important in an audit decision making environment, and then what can we learn by looking at how men versus women processes this information using technology. But I mean, you would really have to look at, like, there's off the top of my head, I can't think of any reason that that you would expect that men would make decisions of, you know, an audit decision, because at the end of the day, they're making an audit decision. So what, so it's not so much the what you're thinking about, the fraud risk assessment. It's really the elements of the system that might be different, right? There's certain elements of the audit system that might be, women might interpret those types of cues differently.
Right.
So I don't know that a fraud risk is the right.
I don't know, right? You'd have to search the literature, maybe even deep in the science literature, to find different components of
usually it's about empathy. Like, so I can think of something off the top of my head. Like, you know, there's research that shows women, in general,
right,
more empathetic or more nurturing. And so you'll see literature in the management literature about leadership styles. Right? Right. So you might, so that's the thing, you would have to really get into the literature on gender dynamics.
Yes.
Right? To say, okay, how then is this relevant in terms of auditing, and then how with the use of expert systems or decision aids or, you know, technology.
So what if, I mean, hypothetically speaking, you found some support to say that, you know, women tend to pick up on red flags or cues that are visually based, right? Versus men.
Actually, when we searched for the literature, we found a paper that was, you know, was also about behavioral experiments, and it shows that the female can make better judgment than males. So,
but in what context?
Yeah, we'll do more.
Right. That's a perfect, because right, that's a very, because you have to look at what context did they examine the judgment, and there was a, given that context, was it a context, for example, like Sean just said, where information was presented visually versus information presented in some other form. So that's what you have. You look at the nuances. You can't just, because in this, you've just replicated, replicating her experiment and said, okay,
she,
I want to see men and women behave differently. And I don't know if they, well, they didn't. And I don't know, even in this, without knowing that experiment, why they would behave differently. You want to flush that out, right? So another thing is, what is also interesting about technology is that there's a whole literature on STEM, right? You know, there's a whole push to get women, to young girls at an early age, to be more involved in science, technology, engineering, and math, right? And so that you would want, if you were to pursue something like this, I would replicate.
So about age?
No, STEM. It's girl, women, and that's the case. There's this whole push to start women, young girls, at an earlier age to expose them to STEM, right? It's the STEM area: science, technology, engineering, and math. Because women tend not to go into those fields. There's a reason. I don't know why.
Right. What she's saying is, right, as if you looked into the STEM, like why they decided to do that, you might find a basis for saying women learn.
Right. Or why
like
women?
That.
Why is
not
so? That might give you some ideas on, okay, why, you know, why, right, what is it, right, what is it, you know, what do we know from that research, you know, that we can now look at, you know, in terms of cognitively how women process information, or what, you know, what components of information are important, and so forth and so on. Why, what could we learn from, for example, that area of research that we could then look at and say, okay, well, is
how
this going to, right. Does that mean we should be training women differently in the use of audit technology than we would men, right? Or when are we going to expect that women are not going to, let's say for example, accept the decisions of expert systems, because they're less likely to accept it because we don't trust technology. That's what you want to look at, not replicate her. You want to have a basis for saying that, you know, women might behave very differently, or
men and women might approach the use of expert systems or the use of technology and auditing very differently, right, than men, and here's why, and that's a real issue, right, because it impacts their judgment. So that's what I would, not to just, you know, replicate that experience, because we have no basis to believe that women would use this tool any differently, and we didn't see any gender difference.
Do you happen to find a theory that supports some sort of difference? I'm not exactly convinced that it should be a repeated measures design,
mm-hmm.
right? So maybe, from what I've read, even as you can justify that. So maybe you could have different conditions, right? You can look at two different IDs and just kind of see how it like, affects.
It might be different types of, very different types of technology.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So it might be where one, they're using an expert system, and then the other might be, you know, some simple technique of decision aid, right? So two different types of decision aid, or the along the spectrum of the complexity of the system, right? Is it a simple, you know, you were talking use an idea, or using an expert system? Right, AI. So you might want to look at that, you know, not only is it, you're looking at the gender, the male, you know, gender, but the type of expert system or type of technology or complexity of the technology really matter. Yeah.
So maybe we can design the research that can test different kinds of technology.
Right, but before you even go there, you want to have a basis
yeah.
for because I'm just throwing stuff out. I don't know that because I don't know. I'm just throwing it out based on well, hey, initially when I read it, that's where I thought you were going with my first look at it with audit technology. It's like okay, this might, maybe this has something, you know, kind of tries to draw on STEM, that the fact that, you know, women are not going in at the same numbers in those fields as men. And so there's this whole initiative that is meant to expose women at a young age, young girls, and so that they're comfortable. And it's even the way that they're taught, right? There's research that shows it's the way that educators teach women in those fields as early as exposing them to math. That ends up, so there are biases that they educate this brain at that early age that influences a woman, a young girl's decision as to whether or not she wants to enter into one of those fields.
So basically, you just have to have a reason to expect there to be some sort of gender bias in this. And then kind of looking at it across different types of technology or complexity and things like that, I think that that's a really interesting thing to be able to do that. I think that
but you want to start with the cognitive psych literature on gender, regarding gender, how women process versus how men process information, if there's any difference. And I suggested starting, you know, if you do a Google search on STEM, a Google Scholar search on STEM, there's probably a whole bunch of, you know, it's a good starting point to direct you to some relevant site research.
I don't even have a problem if you still want to do a DB that's a measure of change in judgment, right?
Mm-hmm.
To see if there are certain types of, or decision aids or technology that improves, right? Maybe there is some sort of bias and this can mitigate it, right? I don't necessarily feel like you have to scrap that particular measurement in your idea.
This is the simplest, you know, measurement of the effect of the audit system, but we will, you know, try to find different kinds of measurements, such as, you know, the maybe we will let the females and males to give a score of or probability of.
Right. Oh, you can come up with a risk. It's the task, right? So you can design it around a task. And I mean, even if you, you know,
wanted to use is the case.
Right.
What I'm saying is you don't want to, what you've done is replicate her experiment.
Yeah.
But you want, if you, it's like the competitive use an established case where we have, because the one cool thing about the case that Daniel used was it, we had a benchmark, right? We knew what the fraud risk assessment should be, like the range that it should be in, right? So that's the one thing about, which I was saying to Ben and Jamie, that's the one thing about using an established case is that you already have a benchmark, right? So you could use the case and you could measure there, but what your inputs are going to be different. What I'm saying is don't use her inputs. If you want to use different inputs, right? And backed by the theory of why you expect there to be a difference, or why there could be, you know, a difference between how men, you know, how gender impacts the use of this technology, and then the use of this technology, you know, impacts their output, the input impacts the output, how they're processing. So the input, I should say, it would be whichever form of technology you choose, or if you look along different dimensions of technology complexity, right? And then what you're trying to gather is here's this input. Do men and women process it differently? And what are the features of it, right? So if you want to have some measure to capture how they're processing information, what features of the technology they're using or not using.
Yeah.
And then how that then in turn, that processing is going to impact their output, which is,
yes.
If you use this case, risk assessment.
Maybe when you want to write down the reasons for decision, so actually when you want to do the scientific experiment to test their decisions, to do a text mining about their decisions, to see if the family or small public.
Cool. So just back to the similar point to Jamie and Ben, if you have them do it online, right? So you have them use, you know, you could see, right? Maybe use the process mining or logs or something capture. Or you can also have them write it down. I mean, that's a matter of, you don't really need text mining to do that because they're not going to write a textbook, right? So you could just, it's just a matter of coding. So you could do something similar to what Danielle did. You could have them talk aloud while they're going through it. So you can do a subsample that talks aloud while they're going through it. Okay. Interesting. I hadn't thought about it. Then we'll ask you, well, how would you develop an experiment from this?
Yeah, we just try to.
Yeah, the second group had a similar, theirs is just a model, and how we kind of walked through and said, okay, well, what would be an experiment?
Because typically, what any research question is kind of like exploring an idea, right? And once you kind of look at that idea, what's the best way to be able to tackle it?
How we can get that.
Usually, you can go into any situation. And say, okay, if I ask a slightly different question, we can measure it. Okay?
So why don't you present your idea, and then we'll kind of try to flesh out what an experiment is.
Okay.
Okay.
more and more widely used and presented in our daily lives. And many big data analytic tools are also widely used in financial industry. These big data analytic tools are very efficient in financial industries because most people in financial industries are having more and more backgrounds in computer science and the information technologies.
For the dependent variable, it's a bit more important.
Because at that point, the auditor issued a clean opinion, right? And now,
now we're saying there's a statement, there's a material misstatement.
Right.
So they're obviously, right, their judgment.
Not accurate.
Right. It's a noisy matter. Because it also, because the one thing that you have with the financial statements, right, is that the financial statements, the audited financial statements, or the statements that are made public, are a joint product of the client and the auditor, right?
Yeah.
So that's what makes that noise.
Why you can't attribute it to the pure
auditor decision. Yeah, and the reality is, even with that, with these statements, the auditor could issue a clean opinion. But let's go back to the fact that we don't look at 100% of the transactions. So they could have made the right judgment. You know, it would be hard to determine when it was a judgment breakdown, but you know, they could have, based on their assessment of risk and so forth and so on. It's just that the sample transactions that they looked at, that issue was, it didn't come up in the sample. I guess it would depend on the type of mistake.
You guys would have to, again, one of the things that you should do is really define the research question, because are you asking, is the data a challenge or opportunity to audit? You know, depending on what your question is, right? What Helen just said about the fact that auditors are given reasonable assurance, they didn't audit everything. In an experiment, I could just ask you, well,
you can manipulate the facts, right? So in an experiment, so what we're struggling with is not that there's a problem for a risk assessment accuracy. It's just hard to test that orthogonally. Right, it's hard. You don't know. I don't know how you determine that fraud risk was. Because even if you say that the company, there was no, there was no subsequently discovered fraud, that doesn't mean that the auditors had an accurate fraud risk assessment. It just means the fraud wasn't discovered. That's the problem. We're trying to look at
it. High.
Right, archivally. Right, right. You know, that's the problem looking, trying to assess that archivally.
But in an experiment, you can build the conditions in which you know isolate that particular aspect.
Right, so if you wanted to do big data, right, and into whether or not big data improved the accuracy auditor decisions, and you would create a case, right, where, so you don't have to have this cut off, okay, this is what big data is big, because you don't need this before 2013, after 2013, right? What you would have is a case where there's big data, and a case where there isn't, and the only difference is that everything about the case is the same. The only difference is one case that the auditor has access to big data, the other the auditor does not, and measure. But that's experiment, right? Measure, therefore, is assessment.
So if you know, you just can assume that we can find a variable.
Okay, so let's assume you can find a variable for accuracy or five. You might not be, you wouldn't be considered an expert in it, right?
And that's an easy question to ask an experiment. You can capture that very easily.
But, well, since we're doing a make-believe, like you can get this information, right? But at least expertise is not correlated with your academic skills.
Experience, I've seen that was correlated with experience.
Right. I'm just looking at the impact of each of your expectations on accuracy. So the older you are, the more accurate you're going to be. Well, there's research that says.
I think it's
right. Right. That says, you know, because age, so you could be a partner. Right? So, which means you're probably old. In most cases, you're probably going to be older than someone that is a staff auditor. Right? And so, there's been some research that shows that the higher you move up in your career, that partners are less skeptical of fraud risk. Right? It would be, you know, when there's incentives or something, I can't remember.
It has to do with
I want to get back to accuracy of corporate business assessment. How do you define the accuracy before this assessment. And let's say you were able to even find the fraud risk assessment hard copy, which you can't, but let's just pretend. How would you determine what's accurate? How do you know, would you define accuracy based on that? Because all you're gonna have, all you could possibly have is the auditor's fraud risk assessment. What makes it accurate?
What could you possibly measure it?
So you're saying that you're basically what you're limiting it to then is did they give a clean opinion and it turns out the company had fraud?
Right.
Because that's the only
way. Still, how do you measure it?
Where are you getting the information? So let's just say you have the auditor's fraud risk assessment. Your variable that you're operationalizing is accuracy. How do you measure accuracy? Like if you could get that information, what is that? Like where is that information coming from?
Right, to be able to
say it's accurate versus not, because the whole thing about a risk assessment is it's just that, it's an assessment. You have to have a benchmark. You have to have some benchmark to be able to say that it's accurate or not.
You know, a benchmark.
If it's an accurate assessment, like say for example, in the case that Danielle used, right, it was a case based on a real audit, right? So they had the outcome, right? So, and it was a case that was tested many, many times, right? So you had a benchmark, you had a normative benchmark. Also in her case, she, you know, and I think it was the original case, they benchmarked it with experienced people.
That's what I'm saying, but you can't do that.
Right.
Case because
so that's why you can say, so, you know, that's why she, in the case, you can say, you know, the accuracy of the fraud risk assessment because you had a benchmark to measure it against. And then that's what I'm trying to get with you here, archivally, what would be your benchmark?
Because even if, like, let's say, even if you were able to get the risk assessment,
you don't know if it's accurate.
Right. So it's like, how do we determine if it's good, bad, high, low, appropriate, not appropriate, wrong, right? Right? You can't use an expert panel.
And also what you're doing when you do something archivally, you're looking at a cross section of firms. Right? So you know, what's the benchmark? This goes to the group that was talking about developing the fraud risk model, right? Framework or weighting system. It could be different across industries. But it still doesn't tell me what accuracy is. I still don't understand. Even if you had, there's not going to be any information available that said that this is an accurate form. Like you have to be able to, your thing is that one is an accurate form of assessment, zero is not. What determines it's accurate? Like how are you going to determine it's accurate? Because first of all, the form of assessment is not disclosed. And now you're trying to come up with a variable that's not disclosed. And then you're trying to put some qualifications around it. There are too many unknowns that you just don't. That there's no way you can test this archive. No way you can test this archive.
Is that possible to control the assessment with the credit risk rating?
Well, then that's not fraud, though, right? Then that's credit risk rating. Now that's
you can change the accuracy or fraud accuracy or fraud risk to different variables.
But that doesn't tell you anything about the auditor's judgment. That's the problem, right? Because you're trying to, this is the reason that overwhelmingly research that looks at auditor judgment is experimental. Not that there's some things that you can look at that you might be able to get,
input is very difficult. It's very difficult, and what inferences you can make about auditing judgment is so important.
Yeah, I was
going
to say, you would think that AR and data would expand that, but it doesn't, because you're not including auditor board members. Right? You don't have access to that. Like, the world is expanded, but, you know, confidentiality prohibits auditors.
You know, I mean, so people have looked at, for example, going concern decisions. But again, that, you know, you can say, well, the audit report, you know, the company went bankrupt or filed for bankruptcy or whatever, but they had a clean audit opinion. Well, it becomes messy. You can't say, well, the auditors made a bad judgment. It becomes messy because the information that was available to them at the time that they made that judgment has indicated, right? Is it, you know, in hindsight is 20/20, but they could have had information, and you don't know because you don't know what information they assess to make to come up that they looked at and how they process that information to come up with the decision to not or to it to give or not give a going concern opinion. So you can make better, like, oh, well, it seems like when an auditor issues a going concern opinion and there's a subsequent, when they don't issue a going concern opinion and there's a subsequent, you know, restatement or company goes bankrupt, these are the characteristics of the company that fall into here, right? Which suggests X. And these are characteristics of the companies that fall into the box where they give a going concern opinion and the company goes bankrupt. Right? That's what you can show, but you don't know a lot about their judgment because you know, if you really want to understand their judgment, or if you want, that's when you would develop a case and say, this is what the research has shown has been important information to consider, or here's what the standard said, these are the important aspects to consider. Let's see what the auditor is presenting.
The auditor, let them make that judgment, let them make that assessment.
Then
you have, like, capture your
archival. That's why it's so hard to do JDM correlations. So I think we talked about if we want to ask that question, like if you want to ask this question about big data, right? The one of ways to do it experimentally is to look at the symptom with, you know, the case. Where that one, the control group gets information the way they traditionally get information in an audit now. And the test group would have access to big data. And you can capture how that information changes their decision. And whether or not it improves their judgment around performance assessment. But you want to ask, what information do they use? What information do they search for? And because if you just say, okay, it improves their judgment, as a reviewer, I might argue they have more information. So they produce the information asymmetry. They produce the information asymmetry. Right? You know, if I produce my information asymmetry by having more information, then I can make better decisions. So you want to look at more than just does it produce, does it improve their risks? You want to know how they use it and how they incorporate it. That's more interesting. Right, and did they use it properly? Did they, you know, did they look at everything, or were they able to discern what information is most related to the question, right, or to the assessment? Because you could have a lot of data, now all of a sudden you become inefficient because you're so busy looking at everything, which is, again, interesting within Jamie, was it because, you know, you can see what information they're touching, they're pulling. It's a similar approach in an experiment. You want to capture the information search process. So, I mean, any questions about big data and how big data can be incorporated into audit judgment and how it impacts audit judgment is very interesting, right? And we don't know. But there's this push that says big data, big data, big data, we need to use big data.
data. Firms are developing technology around being able to capture big data for it. So what we can learn how that impacts auditor judgment. I think that's interesting development.
Familiar with the financial capital market, but the behavioral research is not until this year seminar or program I'm not familiar with. But I got some feeling that the two study this area, we need some strong background of the cognitive science or psychology or things like that.
Yes.
So would you recommend some of the ways?
I was trained in JVM, so I took the econometric classes that I had to take to meet the requirements of my program, but then I also took econometric type classes or, you know, a statistical analysis classes in psych, in the psych department at Wisconsin. And I took seminars in the psych department just so, and I did independent study. You know, so a lot of it was just me doing, you know, because I had the benefit of the psych department there, I did stuff in the psych department. And that's what most people who do JDM research, they take the classes in the psych department.
But it's not unsimilar. Like, my first psych class as a PhD student was computational modeling, right? Where we had to use R to kind of non-linearly map the neural networks in the brain, right? And so it wasn't cognitive psych. It had to do more with some of the things that you guys actually have to do in terms of deep learning and stuff like that. So there are some similarities, right? Not to be ignored.
And I do think, especially in the AIS space, and where, you know, like you guys, the jurists, using virtual reality, information overload, and, you know, those types of things, and how people are processing information, and that's information processing, that a lot of that is drawn from, you know, the cognitive literature. So that's helpful, even if you just, you know, decide that it doesn't have to be auditing, right? These are behavioral, we talked about auditing because that's what we do, like, you know, I do. But I also have behavioral research that I've done using, non-auditors, right? That it's, you know, using students, using people on MTurk when I did my in Qualtrics panels.
Yes.
That's that proxy for investors. So, I mean, I think it's worthwhile, especially in the AIS space, because a lot of stuff that you're doing is, you need to really think through how people, because that's, they're processing information, and how does this cognitively change how they, or does it change how they process that information? It's, if you look at the decision research in JIS and decision support system, if there's an experiment, it's probably right. It's drawn from this, you know, the cognitive.
Especially for you guys that are working on projects, maybe with radar, with Hussein, with exceptional exceptions, or even building your own model. Like, when you go to test that model, you have those expectations on how you think it should perform. There's a reason why you think that it should perform that way. And whether you know it or not, there's going to be some sort of psych theory that support the reason why, you know, this model may aid. Maybe it's reducing information asymmetry, maybe it's bringing attention, maybe it's mitigating the motivating the reasoning bias. Like, it's a lot of different things.
Because you're thinking about how this is going to change, or how it can change, how auditors approach a problem and solve that problem. That's based on the cognitive learning, right, or cognitive processing.
It's going to help you with reviewers as well, because if you present papers or kind of submit papers and you can't explain why,
you
know, right. It's gonna come back.
Right. You know, like, okay, well,
you're just making assumptions here, right?
You want to get like that's why I said what's interesting about what you guys presented is not the cast that you use, it doesn't exploit the interesting aspects of using virtual, because it's the did it add or did it not? Like, that is the most basic thing we do as accountants, right? I pick up a statement. The first thing I do is mentally put that statement in my head. Now, I don't get it down to the exact number, but, you know, we all know how to do mental math,
it's
right? To a reasonableness test. That's the first thing I do. Does it? If I look at a set of numbers, the first thing I do is like, does this make sense? If there's a total, because that's how I was trained as an auditor, right? That's how I approach looking at numbers. Not everyone does that. But if you're looking at audit, you know, if you're looking at how auditors make, that's what I said. That task was too simple,
right?
For
the
environment.
System one, system two thinking, right? If it's automatic, it's not really going to involve a lot of
judgment. Right.
You want to get to that system two thinking where you're having them think, they have to actually make some sort of judgment, choose between decisions. And so you're trying to push a task towards that, where there's some subjectivity in it.
Right, because in that case, right, it improves not only obviously the efficiency of it, right? I think most people would argue that using this technology should improve auditor efficiency. But what's equally, if not more important, is if I have to trade off, I always want to err on the side of effectiveness.
Yes.
Audit because of risk. Right? You always want to err on the side of effectiveness. And so what you, in all of your experience, what you want to do is develop an experiment. Efficiency is fine, but also that there's audit effectiveness. And where there are the challenges with audit effectiveness comes in those situations where there's higher level of judgment,
yeah.
where things are ambiguous. There, I'll send you guys something. Did you get that email about a 1 day workshop on theory building? I'll send it to you. I can't go because you can't go with Reverend Faculty.
Oh, I know.
I'll send it to everyone. Well, I'll send it to Chow and then she can send it out. I think I still have it. And you know, if you're interested, it's a one and it's open to students.
Absolutely. So remember, if you have questions about any of these things, I'm pretty much right as a PhD student. Just come to us, you know. Feel free. I think one of the perils of being a PhD student is sometimes you think that you can't come into someone's office and work through some things that you think you should know, but you shouldn't know at this point yet. We're still trying to help you go with that. So always ask questions once you graduate. It's different. So I'm just kidding. Any more questions? Thank you guys for participating.
All right, thank you for hearing me out,
listening to me talk about research. Enjoy the rest of the